Dispirited from their failure, Kenta has another depression episode, spouting irrationalities about how everyone's against him. Hibiki somehow manages to calm him down, and shortly thereafter, Marina comes upon them. She's astonished to find the brothers, but has enough sense to get them out of sight as the sky patrol sweeps the area. Afterward, Kenta explains why he's taken criminal actions, showing Marina how G.R.I.P kidnapped his Typhlosion. Impressed with what he's doing, Marina decides to join the brothers' crusades, and she won't take no for an answer. About Marina, I'm not normally one for shipping characters, but she was my one and only anime crush. She was cute and flirtatious, and also strong and independent, I guess, but we guys don't typically care for stuff like that. Anyway, since I obviously couldn't have her as a waifu, I took comfort in knowing that Kenta could. She and I were around the same age at the time. Now I'm almost 30, and she's still an ageless child, which is a strange feeling. It's a reminder that characters never truly die until everyone forgets they existed. By the way, when you die, you'll be switched to character status. I suggest you live a memorable life. Back in the story, Kenta remembers the rocket hideout in Mahogany Town, and the group makes their way over for refuge. On the way, Kenta goes into his third flashback about how he very nearly bled to death after being shot. He subconsciously prayed to God for life, and Salamence's miracle tears closed his wound. He was then defibrillated by a thundershock from the Zapdos that became his. Yep, so there was God. Love him or hate him, he tends to be there, hanging out at the edge of eternity. And other places, if you're looking for him. The group reaches Mahogany Town, and Kenta and Hibiki duck into the rocket hideout, where they are greeted with enthusiasm. The brothers discover that most of the rogue teams from various regions have gathered in temporary alliance, and this includes the group originally responsible for the snag machine. Their leader informs Kenta that their old snagger, Wes, still had his snag machine tucked away somewhere. Newly encouraged, Kenta heads back out to the Ore Desert the next day. I have to say, I gave the Ore region a lot more credit than it deserved. Pokemon Colosseum is the world's coolest game for about 3 minutes, and then it becomes mediocre. Kenta and Hibiki arrive at the outskirts stand, where they eventually run into Yuki, and by extension, her boyfriend Wes. The two seem to be in low spirits and dressed in mourning clothes, so the brothers simply tail them to Agate Village. There, we see that there's a funeral going on for another Colosseum character, Old Man Egun. Egun, what a stupid name. I took pity and made it a surname while giving him the first name Mythos for his status as a myth trainer. Still not very good. Anyway, the funeral really has nothing to do with the G.R.I.P decrees or Kenta's revolution, but I wanted to show that there's life happening outside the obsessions of the protagonists, and all their worldly scramblings have little consequence in the face of eternity. Yeah, I know, I've said this already. I'll stop now. This part was definitely influenced by that one song written by Switchfoot. Gone, I think. Anyway, Wes confronts Kenta and asks to talk, but before anything can come of it, Maikeru shows up. Turns out, he wanted to attend the funeral as well, but he decides that detaining Kenta and Wes are the priority. As the two veterans battle, Hibiki notices that Maikeru has Steven's Metagross for some reason. Wes turns over his snag machine, which was with him the whole time, and Hibiki uses it to capture Metagross. The local sky patrol arrive to back Maikeru up, but the brothers drive them away. Afterward, Wes wishes Kenta luck, and they return to the rocket hideout. Here, Kenta does something that locks him firmly out of any lawful or good alignment. He gives each criminal team a master ball. He requests that they not use the balls for evil purposes, which gets him a scathing rebuke from one of the rocket recruits standing nearby. Kenta then leaves, and shortly afterward goes into another depression spell over what he's done. Hibiki eventually comes out of the base as well, to find that Yusin is waiting for him. Marina's called him in as sort of a mercenary for locating a legendary Pokemon, in this case, Mewtwo. They head out in Yusin's Range Rover. Inspiration for this next part comes courtesy of the little-known Pokemon movie, Mewtwo Returns. The party travels all night, then up the windy slopes of Mount Kena, where Yusin suspects Mewtwo may possibly be hiding. They reach a cabin by early morning, where Yusin knows a guy that will let them stay. It's a veterinarian who once nursed him back to health, calling himself Mr. Darai. This right here is my most direct reference to Phoenix Rising. If you haven't read or listened to it yet, one of the main characters is a guy called Merlin DeRye. While I'm considering Phoenix Rising parallels, I've now also got a funeral scene, characters who are constantly on the move, and in a moment, conversation with an all-powerful Mew clone. Yep, so Kenta picks up on the strange way physics work around the so-called Mr. DeRye and asks him who he really is. It's Mewtwo, projecting a long-distance image, and he's as distrustful of humans as ever. As the two ask questions back and forth, trying to build a better understanding, Mewtwo finds out that Kenta gave Team Rocket a Master Ball. He's understandably outraged, but Kenta pleads that he did it to provide a semblance of balance to Japan's new power structure. Mewtwo still finds the grip decrees to his liking, since it means less Pokemon become slaves to humans. So, Kenta shares his fourth and final flashback to make Mewtwo reconsider. This is where the audience confirms that Kenta wasn't exaggerating when he feared that Grip was seizing the power of the Pokemon trainers for themselves. In the flashback, he'd snuck into the Pokemon League, and with Karen's help, discovered an underground facility that the Elite Four were unwittingly guarding. Within were multiple floor levels of seized Pokemon, with the strongest at the bottom. Also lurking below was an operation in which another Mew clone was underway. This was why Kenta now came to Mewtwo for help. Of course, this is also where I remind everyone that Kenta is gold, in spite of how he dresses and the Pokemon he uses. I know that two-letter password AU wasn't very clever, but there you go. Back in the present, Mewtwo still isn't ready to help, and the group retreats without success. In the car, Yusine presses Kenta about being a Pokemon master, and Kenta gives a little insight on how it works. I've watched the Pokemon anime since it first started, and up until the end of the Johto series. To my understanding, there is no clear process of how to be a Pokemon master. I just know that, in the show, you need 8 badges to compete in the league tournament against other people who also earned 8 badges. Even if you win first place, it still doesn't necessarily mean you gain master status. In the games, you only become a master if you beat the Elite Four and overcome their champion. So, I combined the two, and made it so that winning a tournament would earn you the right to challenge the Elite Four. I also added the choice clause, in which beating the champion would give you the choice to seize or refuse the throne. This concept is consistent with the games, and I'm pretty proud of it. Anyway, Yusin's been driving all night, so he gets too tired to go on. Marina insists that they stop at a local hotel, and doubly insists that they purchase a room so she can shower. The group approaches the reception desk looking super weird, and the employees are immediately suspicious. But they let them in. This isn't exactly meant to be a humorous story, but I consider the hotel scene to be the funniest part. Is that another social norm I'm breaking? Pointing out when I think I'm funny? It's probably just the narcissism talking. By stark contrast, the darkest moment in the story immediately follows. The employees recognize Kenta and Hibiki from wanted posters, and call the number given, which winds up drawing a hired hitman into the place. Before he arrives, they send drugged water to the room, and Hibiki finds himself more or less tranquilized. The hitman arrives with a choke wire, and Kenta and Marina ambush him. Kenta slashes off his right thumb, then threatens further torture unless the man reveals what he knows. Turns out the brothers had been marked for death for a while, and the hitman was constantly only a few steps behind them. Kenta, Marina, and Hibiki flee as Officer Jenny arrives, with a new appreciation for how dangerous Grip actually is. I'll be totally honest, I don't know what I was thinking when I wrote this part. It wasn't in my plans, it just sort of wrote itself. Funny how that happens sometimes. Whether it was a smart or dumb idea, I like how it turned out. The trio lands in a nearby forest, leaving Yusine to answer for himself to the police. Kenta is adamant that Marina stay away from him as long as he has a target on his back, and Marina protests in vain. They share a kiss, then decide that Marina should lay low for a while in Katone's house. Hibiki is tasked with convincing Katone to let Marina in, which is fitting because he knows Katone, but difficult because he likes her. This is the romantic part of the story. He succeeds, but only with a lot of awkwardness and dumb luck. Kenta later tells him he did really well, obviously out of blind brotherly love. I had a bunch of fun when I wrote this part. Voicing it was a blast as well. You gotta enjoy what you do, or it just isn't worth it. That night, Kenta confesses that he has regrets about not accepting champion status when he beat Lance. If he had, he might have been able to stop the GRIP legislation with the power of his position. He resolves to do better and dons his old trainer garb that distinguished him as Master Gold. The following morning, when they meet up with Master Red, the latter immediately recognizes him. Of all the Pokemon lore, and there's lots of it, the most celebrated event amongst fans is the secret climactic battle that took place on Mount Silver between Red and Gold. I had to capture the essence of that encounter again, just for a moment. The problem is, Red never talks, and I couldn't think of a way to write it so that he wouldn't seem deaf and dumb, or like a condescending asshole. So I made up another explanation, that Red gets real quiet before battling. I hope I did him justice. I like Red, just not nearly as much as Gold. Red brings the brothers into the mountain cave that's become his home. There, they meet up with Bill, who had to run for his life after he refused to tell GRIP how his Pokemon storage system transport worked. Since then, he's been crafting a machine designed to interfere with his own system teleport, so that GRIP can't arbitrarily take Pokemon from people anymore. This goes to show that Kenta hasn't been the only person plotting to take on the new imperialist government. Kenta asks Red and Bill to join him for an upcoming tournament, where he intends to enact the final phase of his plan. Both men quickly get on board. Curtis hasn't shown up in the story for a while, so Kenta checks in with him. It's been a few days since their last contact, and there's been a lot of business at the Pokeball Craftsman's residence. You'd think that GRIP would have closed in on them by now, but Azalea is a pretty small, out-of-the-way village. With the quiet support of the local police, Curtis and Kurt are on the verge of finishing their project. Kenta advises Curtis to flee the country before he begins his revolution, but Curtis insists that he wants to be there for it. Kenta relents and tells Curtis to buy a seat for the upcoming Pokemon League tournament and bring along as many clients as he can. With that, there's just one more thing left to do: check the status of the criminal teams and what they did with their Master Balls. Back at the Rocket Hideout, Kenta finds out that nobody has caught a legendary Pokemon yet, except for the former Cypher Renegade, Ein. Ein's a sort of penitent villain whose story goes largely untold, but we know that encountering Wes and Ho-Oh caused him to drastically rethink his life. You could say that his alignment changed from neutral evil to chaotic neutral, then to chaotic good, and it left him pretty shaken up. Before he shows Ho-Oh to Kenta, Ein sternly warns him not to underestimate her, because her presence forces people to see themselves for what they really are. Yep, I brought Ho-Oh into this story. How could I not when Gold's the protagonist? I know that I inject Christian stuff into my writing at times, and some people may find it annoying. But this time, it was already three-quarters written. Come on, it's a glowing bird that brings creatures to life and rises again after it dies.